All right, let's do this. Hey, everyone, welcome to Bronyville. Woo! We survived. The internet didn't just drop us off a cliff after last episode, so that sounds good. Yeah, Bronyville episode 2, recorded on April 30th, 2011. Hello, everyone. I am your host, going by apple cider on this thing. Might as well use code names. It's more fun that way. Anyway, also have a returning champion at this point, Chef Sandy.
Hello.
Howdy, howdy. Sitting all the way to my south left, about 1,000 miles away.
Yep.
That's a made-up direction.
South left?
South left by 1,000 miles.
I'll buy it.
Yeah. I was trying to figure out from where I'm sitting south left. Okay. And new face on our little stream here, and we actually can see each other this episode, so it shouldn't be as crummy. He's decided to go by Fluffy Hoof.
Thanks, guys. Great to be here.
Awesome. Okay.
Welcome to the herd.
Yeah, we're doing ponies again this week. Who would have thought on this show? So, we actually have a ton of stuff, but hey, why don't we just break it off into just normal chatter? Anything you guys had going on? Any, you know, pony-related, not pony-related? Me fighting a cold mostly for the past week. Lucky we didn't do a show on Sunday because I was, you know, one of those colds where it's just like, oh, hey, I'm feeling all right. Then by the end of Sunday, I need to lay down.
Took it right out of you, did it?
Oh, man. My girlfriend's dealing with it right now. Just checked her 104 fever, so.
Oh, jeez.
I know.
Wow. Give her hugs. Yeah. Hugs from the bronies.
Yeah, no girlfriend this episode. I know that there was at least one person who really appreciated. Like, she was my favorite person. She would just say catty comments and correct your dumb faces when you were wrong. Sorry, not this episode.
Those were always my favorite characters.
Anything else? Chef? Floof? Anything you guys
want to do? The most exciting pony-related thing is I went on a grand adventure here in North Texas trying to find the little $2 pocket ponies. They do not exist here up in DFW.
I'm saying Best Buy, but that ain't the right one.
It's Big Lots.
Big Lots, there you go.
Big Lots, and went by Toys R Us, and had a couple women give me odd looks because I was looking at the gift set that has the pocket ponies and Celestia, and I was like, what? They kind of look away and walk off.
You need to plan ahead for that sort of thing. Like, I was going to go shopping for some toys myself, and I was just going to, if anybody gave me any odd looks, I would say, niece. That's all you need to do,
good
is just
one.
Niece.
Daughter, if you think you could pull it off for daughter.
Daughter,
this is probably a good one. I actually
could be creepy and say, you know, Applejack's my favorite.
I love me some Applejack.
I got more rarity. Really creep it up a little. I actually kind of pondered that. I was just getting into everything when they were doing the whole McDonald's stuff, and I was like, right on the edge of just like, should I go in there and get those? Because I kind of want them, but I kind of don't want to come off as a creep. And then I go through the drive-thru a few days later, and it's Barbie, and like, damn you, confound you.
I always feel a little awkward ordering a Happy Meal anyway. But I think I would have done it for ponies if I had known about it back then.
Yeah. See, I came on. Watching the show at the tail end of that, so I missed out entirely.
Yeah.
I mean, you can just buy the toys for like $1.50.
Yeah, you can go up to
eBay.
As far as I'm aware, depending on the location you go to, and you get early enough, you can just go up to the register and be like, hey, give me toys, you know.
Oh, you mean like at McDonald's, you can just buy them from McDonald's?
You don't have
to get those teeny tiny burgers and fries?
I think you can just go up there and just ask for it. You have to find a nice, somebody who works at McDonald's that is rather nice, and then just plead and
when
say,
their shift first starts.
It's like, this is for my niece. And be like, all right, here you go, pedophile.
That's pretty cool. You know. So I gave up on buying Happy Meals ever since they stopped coming in boxes and they started putting them in bags. That's no fun. That's not happy for me.
Well, knowing the popularity of ponies, hopefully they'll be back.
How many Beanie Baby runs did they do at McDonald's? And that was exactly
Barbie and Hot Wheels.
Well, Barbie's always going to be popular. Yeah. Those are their default toys. If there's nothing else out, they go to Barbie and Hot Wheels.
Just be like, let's see. So we're done with that run. What should it be? Just put that white girl on again.
They all love the white girls, right?
Yeah.
That's what kids are into.
White girl. She's got hair. They brush it, right? Next. Just imagining Ronald McDonald in just a really just crummy outfit. Just like, all right. The girls like that, and the boys like the cars. Next. Anything else, or should we get on to brony stuff? The bronage.
Nothing noteworthy on my end.
All right. Well, let's do this. Actually, since we got Floof on, we got to know a little bit more about you. There's a few things that we started on our first episode, so we got to break it down. First off, favorite character.
Oh, geez, you're putting me on the spot.
Yep, favorite character.
Favorite character, hands down, even before this week, was Pinkie Pie.
Oh, he's a crazy.
I'm just a Pinkie kind of guy, because I find myself, like, bursting into spontaneous song occasionally, and I can relate to that, I feel.
And you really like cupcakes. And you really like cupcakes.
Not anymore.
No, okay.
I don't. I'm never going to eat another cupcake so long as I live, so help me, pony. Celestia. So help me, Celestia.
I am so happy I've never read that story and have no intentions to.
I almost had nightmares last night.
Yeah. Crazy grim dark.
It's not fun. Far away from that.
When there's something out there that 4chan says, I need to take a break... You know,
wow.
When 4chan itself says, all right, listen, I need to go lay down for a little bit, I realize how bad it is. When people on 4chan have to make alternate endings to feel better.
They do that? Because I was planning on doing that myself. I'm like, it can't end this way. I won't let it end this way.
Yeah, there's like 5 of them because people are just like, and then Pinkie Pie woke up and everything was fine.
Yay, dream sequence. I'm going to have to search for those to see if I can't find get a restful night's sleep tonight or something.
You very well might need. Okay, next one. Which was the last episode you watched, I suppose, most recent?
As opposed to the most recent was probably Owl's Well That Ends Well.
Okay, so you did Party of One and then the one before that. Okay.
I watch them in order. I'm a continuity kind of guy.
Okay, but you have seen Party of One.
Oh, yes.
Okay, all right.
Twice.
Just double checking there. Favorite episode thus far?
Thus far? Oh, geez, that's... I'd have to give a little bit of thought, but if you're going to put me on the spot, you're going to answer at me right now.
Yeah, exactly.
It would probably be the Cutie Mark Chronicles.
Good. Yeah, that's a good one.
Just because I like backstory, I like character development, and that was, like, lousy with it.
Actually, who was your favorite of the Chronicles? That's a good one to kind of pull
the
up.
Favorite of...
That'd be a good one for all of us. Let's start with you, and then we can go around. I'm kind of curious.
The favorite pony origin?
Yeah.
Or I guess, Cutie Mark origin
story?
Just
that story, yeah.
Oh, gee, let me think back. Let's see. Fluttershy fell off of a cloud.
Yeah.
And then she sang a song. I wasn't too happy about that.
By the way, spoilers, everyone, if this is important.
Oh, if they haven't seen it by now, then they're behind the times. Actually, you know what? I think it might have to be Rarity just because of that one, the giant rock parody video that was up on YouTube today.
I do have to agree hers was pretty good, if not for the, you know, entire sequence of being drug unwillingly across the ground. And just
that
look
funny.
Of displeasure,
yeah, that.
That was pretty damn good.
Her VA...
go ahead.
I was going to say, her VA certainly gets the frustration across very well.
Yes, she does.
This is the point where I cut in a rock, as you know.
A rock? That's my destiny? What is your problem, Horn? I followed you all the way out here for a rock? Dumb rock!
Put that into the stream at some point. Let's see. God, I don't know. Twilight's was really crazy for what it was.
I like that. I saw that and like, oh my god, she's the goddamn Jean Grey of ponies.
Yeah, there you go.
Did anybody else notice that?
And then the entire fact that Celestia is just sitting outside just like, yep, it's time, you know. At first just like, oh no, she's just randomly here. But I'm just like, this is backstory. She knows what's going on.
Oh yeah, she does. She could feel that power coming.
She's like, I know that. I know what you are. You're going to be an element of something. And then we're going to have a show. All this
I also kind of like Pinkie Pie's because she grew up on an Amish rock farm.
Yep.
Which I think was very counter to her character nowadays.
I am kind of disappointed in Applejack's, though. That was pretty basic, but, you know, I hope maybe that more happens with that. That was just like, I left town, and then I got back, and hey, it's here.
Hooray.
My favorite one was Pinkie's.
Mm-hmm.
Just because you don't know for sure if she's being honest about it, because then when they leave... out of the wagon. It's like, I'll tell you my story later. A little bit
exactly.
Joker with the, did I ever tell you how I got my cutie mark?
Yeah, that actually
And of course, the next episode, they go on, and it's sort of true at least.
I think that her cutie mark origin story kind of clashes with what she was telling Twilight in Winter Wrap-Up about how, you know, she was a fun skater when she was little, and then her grandmother telling her to just laugh at ghosts. in the pilot.
I hope so much it is something where we just keep hearing a new origin story each time from her.
That would be cool. I would be down for that.
It's just
She's gonna show you a magic trick and make some gems disappear.
That would be fantastic if she just kept coming up with another, you know. Oh, and this happened. So yeah, that totally makes sense. Okay, so last two for Floof. Why is this show so freaking addictive, and what is the reaction of those around you who know that you're obsessed?
Addictive? It's like my rainbow crack cocaine. I can't get enough of this stuff. Stable keeps telling me, you love the ponies more than you love me, and I'm like, no, that's not true, but I'm going to go back to reading this fanfic right here, hon. Just don't wait up for me. You can go to bed if you want. And that pretty much sums up the reactions of those around me. They're like, oh, you like the ponies? Yeah, I guess that's pretty cool. One of my friends told me that I had crossed over to the dark side, and I had to tell him, no, it's actually pretty colorful over here.
Yeah, I've already had somebody on my Twitter feed tell me that I'm in need for an intervention at this point, so.
You don't do as many pony tweets as some people, though, so I think you're still safe and sane.
I was fully expecting to see my Twitter feed, just the numbers just start dropping, but they're slowly going up, so I guess I'm doing something all right.
I was going to say, I am terrible about tweeting about pony stuff. My icon is Derpy Eye Dash from Fall Weather Friends, and I have had people tell me that I really need help, and I'm like,
it's a nice icon.
You know, deal with it.
Yeah, really, what is the I have to say, Derpy Eye Dash, even better, was the crazy eye pinky in the most recent episode. Oh, crap.
Yeah.
It's like, oh. Like creepy pies.
On the subject of Twitter icons, your Twitter icon is surprisingly unponied.
I know. I'm keeping it real for right now. I don't know. I'll have to decide what I'd have to do. I'd probably end up rocking a rarity or something. So we'll see. So got that reaction of those around you. Should we hit the news? Because we got a lot to actually cover on this.
Some good news. Yeah.
Okay, I think the first one that we have on here, I didn't even put any additional notes because I think we all have some really good insights and some really good ideas into this. First one, an open letter to the Brony community. So let me pull this up real quick. And all of this great news coming across on my favorite website to find out anything in this crazy fandom is Equestria Daily, or currently Equestria Madness, which you can find at equestriadaily.com. But this was posted over the week, was posted on Thursday. There we go. So yeah, I can actually read at some point. But this was posted, and it was a pretty good letter, an open letter to the Brony community, just trying to figure out, you know, there's some contention, and I guess, you know, we probably need to figure out a way to summarize it. Anybody want to jump in before I end up, you know, eating up the mic time and giving their interpretation?
He does a pretty good TLDR, yeah. Just go ahead and read that.
Yeah. Oh, the TLDR? All right, let's see. I got to yank that up real quick. Hey, Google Docs. Yeah, there's several pages. And there's already 15 people already doing this. All right, TLDR. Yeah, I know I was doing it was really long, and this was by... I'm trying to say the name is pretty fun, too. Imbleshit. I'll say it like that without it being, you know, without it... you know, sounding like what it probably was meant to sound like. So, it was just this entire discussion about a potential schism inside of the Brony community, dealing with who has ownership and, to some extent, who believes who should or shouldn't be part of it. So, let me read the TLDR section. TLDR, yeah, I know it was really long. Here's the recap of those who don't want to read a lot. The MLP fan base is no place for hate and name-calling. It is a place for love and tolerance. Just because somebody, some pony, likes something you don't, doesn't make it wrong. We, as a community, need to learn to be accepting of other fans, from the furries to the shippers, the clopfip riders, to just plain old MLP fans. Because at the end of the day, we all share a love for My Little Pony, Friendship is Magic. Deep down inside, we are all bronies. And believe me when I say that even though I don't know all of you, and even though I may not meet most of you, I love you. I love you guys. Sincerely yours, Ben Sims. As I said, this is a multi-page document written here, a manifesto to some extent. So what were your, I mean, just reading through the whole thing, let's go with, hey, Chef, what did you think, just starting out?
I saw it posted initially off PonyChan and saw the initial reactions. Most people were pretty much, you know, it's like, yeah, it's, we really should try to love and tolerate people. And, of course, there's the naysayers, the, you know, oh, these people need to get the...
No, don't worry, I can play with that. What should be the sound file I replace with that today? Any suggestions? I did the woo from Apple Buck season. Do we have any? I'll figure something.
Works.
Out. Don't worry.
Sorry.
Okay. Don't worry.
Surprise us.
I'll figure out something. Don't worry. Maybe something Spike related, just to make it fun. Anyway, keep going.
But most people were pretty accepting. The people that wanted people saying that other people should just get out. Well, they're the minority. It's the internet. Everyone's gonna have to. You know, people are gonna pull out the things they hate. But you know, there's not much you can do about it.
Well, Fluff, what about you? Do you read through it? What was your take?
I read through it, and then I thought that his fears were well-founded, that I could definitely see that happening. I wrote him a thank you letter saying, yeah, that pretty much sums up how I've been feeling. I really hope that it stays nice. And that his letter was actually what prompted me to go on to PonyChan for the first time and to just look around. And from what I found, there's not a whole lot of hate going on over there.
Oh, it's crazy.
A lot of the comments that were posted on the blog update on Equestria Daily were, there was a good mix, actually, of people who were hating and people that were just, meh, whatever, yeah, you're right, or TLDR, even the TLDR. But I guess his fears weren't, I don't want to say weren't well-founded, because I think there's still the chance that it could schism, but from what I gather, a lot of the people are very accepting, and I think that we can get past it.
Mm-hmm. Well, I actually kind of agree that there could be the schism coming up, and it's the let me just, well, I'll explain what I mean by a schism coming up, and then I'll break this down into what I believe the two things that could cause this are. First, you know, we do have the big break coming up. You know, which we're probably going to be probably 9 months, 6, 9, maybe 12 months till, you know, the series reopens, till we get more. And so we're going to be dealing with a period of time where the community itself is going to have to kick into a self-generation mode, where they're going to have to start, you know, all right, we've got to feed off of each other, you know, depending on how that goes, can go, you know, sideways or it could go great. The schism I see is based off of the fact that the community, when it was originally founded, when it started its growing, was grown mostly on 4chan CO board and was founded on the B board. Pretty much CO fed into B, and that became its big thing. It grew from there. It became much well-known. It became bigger. Different groups jumped in, and, of course, one of the other groups that jumped in are the furs. And the thing with that is that 4chan doesn't exactly take too kindly to them, and they're, you know, kind of, sort of, clash, definitely in the past, that kind of weirdness. So I think that's the kind of the schism, is the there's kind of thoughts on particular things of, oh, hey, this artist created something, and to some people they'll click and they'll be like, oh, this link goes to Fur Affinity. Forget that. I'm not going to pay any attention because that's something I don't even want. They ruin and corrupt things. That's how I interpret it, you know, the entire fact that there's one side that does this and, you know, the other side's mostly like, what?
Never mind the fact that a lot of the people within, say, the furry community probably found it initially off 4chan anyway.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact that the two are so heavily colonized with each other, it's pretty hard to say, oh, I'm purely this, I'm mm-hmm. purely that. You know, the sheer number They're of furry like the... threads that pop up off B is, don't go there, kids.
Yeah, go Fluff away.
They're yet. Almost like the two step-siblings that hate each other at the same time. They're so sad at each other because one of them didn't get the top bunk or something.
Yeah, it really is just an animosity towards each other that is... One of the things that was pointed out by one of the posters in the comment thread on Equestria Daily was they were like, well, I mean, the furs have done this before. They've done terrible things to other franchises. And the one that they cited so much was, you know, the Sonic fandom. And being like, you know, they've taken Keith's characters and completely just, like, over-sexualized them, turned them into these very bizarre things, and, you know, have done this. And they will do this again, and this is something we care about, that they care, you know, we care about, the creators care about, and we don't want them messing with it.
Although, you know, I've noticed that they haven't done so much with My Little Pony. Like, a friend of mine says that he went and was looking for some pony naughtiness, and he couldn't find a whole lot. Like, he went to his sites, and all he found were, like, fan art pictures, and there was, like, a smattering of smut in there. So I think that it's mostly wholesome.
Rule 34 exists for a reason, and it's ponies is no exception. But I do see people shying away from at least over-sexualizing it. You know, there are characters... I've seen people that do the porn, but in those same threads where people post that, I see people going, oh, come on, really? Personally, I don't want to see 34. I'm not going to read Klopfic. I mean, I like shipping to a degree, but, I mean, that kind of stuff, I don't want involved with the pony fandom.
I totally tried to read some the other day, and it made me sick. I was like,
it's one of those things where I like the show for its innocence and just childlikeness, I guess. I don't know how you want to put it. And you don't want to see that kind of innocence sullied by, you know, some guy wanting to jerk it off to Rainbow Dash. That's just not cool.
Yeah,
whatever floats your boat, it doesn't hurt me if other people are going to do that, but that's something that I personally am going to not involve myself with.
Yeah, I think I've heard that kind of sentiment a lot of just like, listen, this is something that we care about, the community care about, that a lot of people care about. So it, from what the sounds that I'm hearing, especially out of those camps, is just the entire thing of like, you know, this is good. Don't molest it. Don't do anything bizarre to it. If it, you know, if it starts to stink, then they'll jump on it like wild dogs, just deciding to take it down at the first scent of weakness, because that's weird stuff that they sometimes do. But for the most part, it's just like, no, there's no reason to. It's great in its own right as is. No reason to muck with something that works. And as an aside, and I know that you don't know this, Chef, but I actually had been Imbullshit is close. From where I am, and I'm located in some indescript bunker somewhere in the San Francisco Bay Area there. He actually is in the San Jose area. I reached out to him, contacted him through Instant Messenger, talked to him a bit. Cool guy. He actually may end up helping us out here on the show. He's interested in doing some writing stuff and maybe some editing of the show. So we'll actually have some more designated people to help out. But he stated, and this is something that I hope maybe EQ can reference us for it. He stated he received roughly about 500 emails. Based off of that letter that he posted, because he said, "Hey, if you want to flame me, here's my email address. Go do it. Whatever. You know, I'm not hiding behind this. If you want to say it to me." He said 500 emails. You know, oh, go ahead.
I'm almost surprised it wasn't more, actually.
Well, here's the other thing. 500 emails. He stated of 500 emails, two was disagreeing, and those two were polite about disagreeing. They were like, you know, I don't like it. It's weird. I don't understand it, but I'll accept it. You know, they are completely up to the right of what they want to do. I still find it, you know, bizarre in my own right. And there were a total of zero trolls. Nobody saying you're stupid, you're dumb, you know, die in a fire, you know, all that stuff. The trolls that were all on the comment threads, you know, and they were few. They talked a lot, but they were few. But they didn't, you know, even step up to send an email, which hopefully they won't after hearing this.
This is why I love Brony so much.
There's always going to be disagreements, but I do like the fact that the community is just like, for 98% of it is a bunch of people going, yeah, you know, just as long as you ain't hurting anybody, go, cool. Power
the fact
to you,
that
let's
it was civil.
Awesome.
Exactly, yeah.
You know, address something and, you know, not be complete babies like a lot of arguments and disagreements on the internet turn out to be. Everybody turns into a baby and turns into a troll and makes it be a whole lot more drama. And, of course, there was drama because this was a serious topic to talk about. But still, you know, 98% of people were really civil about it. Maybe the people over at Equestria Daily with their plus 500 posts to that thread may disagree. They actually ended up putting a comment here of, should I lock the comments on the letter post, with 14% saying yes, 15% saying no, and 69% saying Twilight Sparkle. So,
yeah, 752 comments. It's pretty amazing. And far, far too TLDR to go back into.
Yeah, it is. Exactly. I think I even commented kind of early in it, and Chef caught me of just saying, like, so you jumped in on that. I'm like, heck yeah, I'm going to jump in on it. And all I ended up saying was, you know, shouldn't people just like what their own thing? And if you don't like it, just kind of be, oh, whatever, you know, it ain't your thing. So just deal with it.
Love and tolerate them.
I wanted to drop an image macro, but I thought I'd troll too much doing that. The first one I wanted to drop was a "you mad" at some of the trolls, but then I realized that's trolling back.
Yeah, exactly. You're feeding the parasites.
I know. I was like, "you mad?" Like, no, I need to stop that.
No, and that's what makes you the better pony, right there.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Is knowing. Yes,
knowing's half the battle. So I think we've beaten this topic into the ground.
Like a dead horse? No. Okay, that's bad.
No. Very much alive.
Okay, so let's do this. Next one, a big, big topic that came up. So we got the eBay auctions that came in. Lauren Faust, of course, creator of the show and all that is cool and all that is pony, dropped out some eBay auctions to help out just with the Japanese earthquake and not monsoon, but the tsunami thing.
Tsunami.
Yeah. So put out four pictures out there of one of Derpy Hooves, listed as Derpy Hooves, so it's official, guys. This is
yes.
That is a thing now.
That made me happy.
An Applejack, a Pinkie Pie with Pegasus wings, very rare, and a Twilight Sparkle. All of those have concluded. All of those are finished, and the numbers are this. Coming in last place, Derpy Hooves, at $2,151. Moving up from that, Applejack, and I'm kind of sad about this one, but I understand the reason for the next two. Applejack at $3,050. Pinkie Pie with the specialty Pegasus wings at $4,050. And then Twilight Sparkle breaking it at $6,200 for an original sketch.
From 2008.
Woo. Yeah. Now,
2008?
Yeah, that's when she did the original pitch.
So,
oh,
yeah. So
I thought these were recent.
No, well, Derpy was recent. Derpy was recent. Derpy's because recent. She went, oh, this is really popular. Here's your Derpy Hooves.
And then I'm guessing the other three were from way back when, because that's back when Pinkie Pie was like surprise still.
Mm-hmm.
And a Pegasus.
So we had all that craziness ending up in $15,451. The Brony sent for helped out for. The
That's
Japanese
a lot of
victim.
Money.
That is some. I mean, it ain't going to buy them a nuclear reactor, but it will definitely.
15K will get some supply. That's for sure.
That'll definitely help.
That's
out.
That's a lot of blankets. That's a lot of life straws there.
So good going, Bronies, helping out and also getting yourself some really expensive artwork. That's pretty
exactly.
cool.
And you know that she would have raised more if she had more sketches to put out too, because there must have been a lot of disappointed people.
Well, there was actually. There's a really good a point. I was looking on Pony Chan. There was one person who stated on there. He's like, "I'm so bummed because they really wanted Pinkie Pie, if I remember correctly." And they were saying, I sold like all my DS games. I sold so much stuff, and it went over $2,000, which was like their limit. They had sold pretty much everything. It's like. I wanted it so bad, and it just went over their limit. And Lauren contacted them on that thread saying, hey, listen, you know, if you want to help out and do that, I'll sketch you something. You know, just like you
well,
did that.
Well, she said contact
me. Yeah, she said contact me. They'll figure something out, which is pretty, that's pretty damn cool.
You know they were happy. Like, even the fact that she sent them an email probably made their day.
Lauren, if you're listening to this, you're really cool. Would you like to show up on the show? I don't have a bunch of stuff to give away, but I'm here. Hi.
Pretty please.
Yeah, pretty please. That'll be awesome. You guys could be on for it. It will be cool. I don't know. We'll see. Once I feel like we have a few of these down on our belt, we'll see. I got something in the works that would be really fun. But yeah, just continuing on. Good going, Bronies. $15,000. Ooh, man, looking at these numbers, just going like, man, it would have been nice to bid on this, but then I even just look at the values, and I'm like, I wouldn't have even been close.
It'd exactly.
Be like, I couldn't have gotten a fourth of Derpy Hooves' sheet, you know. It's crazy.
I wanted to bid, but I knew all I'd do was drive up the auction price, which actually wouldn't have been a bad thing, but...
Yeah. Well, Equestria Daily actually created a chart where you can see, and it's just like, Derpy started out and it was about at the $2,000 range, and everybody was like, well, that's crazy, and then Pinkie Pie went ahead, and, you know, Pinkie Pie then soared up to $4,000, and then just Twilight just burst through the seams at one point and hit $6,000, which was...
Right after Applejack's auction ended, she just shot through the roof. Just,
I guess there was a fight for Applejack, and, you know... whoever it was lost and just was like, all right, Twilight, there, mine.
Have Applejack. Twilight Sparkle, she's a good second place. She's a good silver medal right there.
She's my waifu. She's not silver medal. I don't know. Maybe Rarity is. They're both kind of fighting with each other. Yeah.
You can have two favorites. It's allowed.
And I will have to say, I've been doing some stuff recently. Applejack really getting up there. Like, I've been kind of relooking at some of the characters. I don't know, just Applejack is starting to seem more and more appealing. I like the kind of the interaction and stuff, so I like the fact that she's a hothead and kind of, you know, crazy. But yeah, it's totally Twilight and Rarity knocking it out. I'm sure if, you know, I see another Rarity episode, she's probably gonna win.
She hasn't She hasn't had her own episode yet, has she?
Applejack? No, she had the Applebucks.
No, Rarity.
Season. Oh, no, she's had
Applejack had Applebuck season.
Rarity had hers, the dress episode.
Yeah, I guess it was kind of her episode right
and,
there.
And then you had the Diamond Dogs, too. Diamond Dogs was really kind of hers.
I want to say that was more spike-ish than Rarity.
Yeah, the Owl episode was more spike-ish. I get a Rarity spike. It was kind of focused.
Yeah.
But just to add to the auctions, one more thing. Firefly, a.k.a. Lauren, on her DeviantArt page, just posted, wow, the My Little Pony sketches raised over $15,000 for Give to Asia. Wow, I'm simply flabbergasted. Thank you for all who participated, especially the winners. You all embody the element of generosity. So all who have contributed are now officially Rarity.
Aww.
The diva in you. So there we go. That does that one. Moving on. Fluffy.
What?
Fluffy.
What am I doing?
You like Weird Al?
Still here. Did I like Weird? Yeah,
Do you like Weird Al?
Weird Al.
He's awesome. Been posting pony stuff recently on his Twitter feed.
I saw that. Two videos so far.
Twice. He posted it twice, which means something. He is officially our Brony overlord. Can this be confirmed?
Is he? I would go so far as to say yes. He's a Brony celebrity, maybe.
Brolebrity? Is Brony that a bit much?
Brony Lebrity. Yes, exactly.
The person who made him, Fluttershy Elisa, though, she did a heck of a job.
Oh, they are great.
Oh boy, did she?
They are synced up pretty much. Fluttershy Elisa made two of them. One of them. The first one being a playoff of Weird Al's Polkorama. Second one that was just recently posted was Angry White Boy Poco. Both of them made by Weird Al Yankovic. The first one, a few days later, Weird Al posted on his Twitter feed, you know, essentially saying, hey, this is the My Little Pony, you know, music video you were all waiting for, and linked to it, which immediately garnered just tens of thousands of hits
for it.
Shot up crazy and made, you know, Fluttershy Alyssa post something on there going, oh my god, holy, you know, pretty much saying, here's my reaction video when going to the Rainbow Dash, oh my gosh, you know, videos.
I think I'd react the same way. Have you guys seen any of her other videos, Fluttershy Lisa's?
They were kind of, at least one that I saw was a little bit odder. They were kind of, I only clicked one.
She has a couple other pretty good music videos, and then she has the My Little Pony Friendship Magic randomness videos. She has three of those that are reminiscent of another untitled internet video from way back when.
Hmm.
But they're pretty good. I highly recommend checking them out. Like 7 minutes of quality time well spent.
Yeah, the first one you could have chopped up as a celebrity coincidence of just kind of like, oh, he found something or somebody linked it to him and he thought it was cool, so he posted it. But then later today he posted the second one, which kind of, you know, okay, wait a second. He posted both. And also the fact that the FIM producers, some of them have reached out to him and been like, dude, if you want to be on the show, we can't set you up. Let's do this. Let's talk. You know, just
Has there been any official response back from him about that?
Not publicly.
I'd be excited to know.
Not publicly.
Still.
I've seen. You know, I'm sure that there's agents talking to agents and figuring out how that would all pan out and figuring out payments and weird stuff like that. And, of course, you know,
I can tell you how it would pan out. It would pan out well.
Well, you know, it's always been a thing that when Weird Al notices you enough to make a parody, you know, you've made it.
So is this opposite time? Now, ponies have made it to the point that Weird Al is referencing them?
Apparently.
So
ponies have, you know, come a long way.
Your camera is freaking me out.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, just...
It's catching that ghost in the hallway.
You, man. Look behind you.
It's catching that ghost.
Is there a murderer? Oh, no!
I mean, keep zooming in on something back there.
You see if I can't stop this crazy
webcam.
It's
getting reflection off that chrome dome of his. That's pretty much what's going on.
Aw.
Yeah.
Don't make fun of my lack of hair.
Yep, I will. Because last time I saw you, you had hair.
Yeah.
Living in Appalachia and now not having hair.
Lots of stuff has changed.
And Appalachia.
I think I'm the only one that doesn't have hair anymore, though.
Everybody else growing more hair to make up for you.
I know. I gave them some of mine.
Okay. And another one I listed in here, just a general kind of fun one. Somebody has made some 3D pony game models and has them running around and doing their whole craziness and doing.
Yes, they are very neat.
I would spend a little bit of time just going, this is so fun. I'm flying and I got rainbows.
Just a little bit of time there, AC?
Yeah, I maybe.
How about a couple afternoons? I don't think I'd sleep for a little while.
Look, I'm going to draw on this
rainbow skill.
I'm going to draw in the sky and switch to Applejack and look up and be like, aw,
those poor Earth ponies.
Hey, they have magic all their own. Lauren stated that they do.
They do. They have their deep connection with the Earth.
Which means they can, like, summon Earth up and, you know, they're mutants.
Exactly.
They have crazy Terra powers. That's how it goes. Okay, we got a few more things to do here before we get into talking about the two most recent episodes, so we can run through this real quick. I have a segment here. Someone give me a word. As of the last episode, I wasn't reading fanfic. As of this one, holy crap, have I started reading some fanfic. I've really started to take off to it, reading some really great ones. I didn't think I would like Swayback as much as I did, but man, Swayback was pretty good. And ways that made me confused. And anyway, but yeah. So we have this little one. We all have added our own pieces in here. I am adding in Junior Speedsters Forever, normal fix, so you don't have to worry about shipping or Grimm or anything like that. But I think actually the one character in the entire show that I kind of have the most, like, I wish they would have done something with was Gilda, because it's the only character, even Trixie, you know, for all of her craziness, apologized and said, you know, I'm sorry, I'm not good, you know. But Gilda just kind of went, whatever, suckers, I'm gone, and left. And I feel like that's kind of like, I don't know, that's the only character that's in the show that just you could definitively go, That one, that's bad. That is bad.
You're not the only person that feels that way, too. I've read four or five of them. They've been like, Gilda's not so bad. Gilda's good.
Yeah.
Gilda's good.
So, yeah, so I'm adding Junior Speedsters Forever. Makes her a decent person. Makes it, you know, so, and I hope they hit it up in the future and kind of bring her back and have her have, you know, maybe, I don't even know if it would be a redemption story, but something where it's like, maybe she had a crummy day, or somebody spilled a latte on her feathers, or something, you know. Give us a little reason for, I think a story of being like, you know, sometimes forgiving would be a good thing to do, especially when somebody was kind of being dumb and can suck down their pride and say, I'm sorry. So,
like a lesson that friendship and magic would teach.
So, I think that one was good. It's definitely a good long read. I know that that Fluffy is trying it right now, so.
It's Fluffy.
Fluffy, sorry.
Fluffy.
All right.
I'm not fat, I'm Fluffy.
Okay, let's see. Good to hear. So, Chef, what you got? Chef Sandy.
The one that I read most recently that I really enjoyed was called Paradise, author Sly Wit. It's posted up chapter 8 and was linked off Equestria Daily. It's sort of it's a Celestia Luna fic, sort of a origin story for Equestria and proper, and basically it starts a couple thousand years ago with them as foals and sort of their growth into the ridiculously magical living goddesses they are. It's only after chapter 8, so, you know, it's still got a long ways to go, but it's a really enjoyable read. The author does a really good job describing scenes and the environment. You know, it's just a good adventure story.
Cool. Normal fic, hopefully no shipping at that point.
Yeah, it's marked as normal. There's no shipping.
Some of the pairings I've seen in the past are bad. Anyway, Fluff.
Trixie.
Trixie. How does that... I've got to find Trixie, that story Trixie. At some point. There's a Trixie yeah. Trixie ship. What?
It involves according her and a mirror.
Her and a mirror.
Magic was involved. Oh. Those crazy college days.
Oh, boy. I sincerely have to find that one. Okay, Floof, what you got?
I recommend the story called Moonbeam. It's another normal fic and another Luna fic, actually, and is also a very long read. They're up to part 9 right now, and the story's still not done. Part 9 was a cliffhanger, and I was really sorry to see that they haven't updated it in, like, a week. But it's about Luna, who's getting a lot of guff around the castle for her whole nightmare moon thing. So she decides she's going to cast her disguise spell on herself and then run away to Ponyville and make friends. And this one has a lot of original character ponies in it, which I wasn't too fond of to begin with. But I think that, let me find, Lawrence Brown was the author, and they did a very good job of developing these likable characters.
That's the thing about Paradise, Chapter 8, sort of a cliffhanger, mid-battle thing, and so it's like, can't wait till the next one drops.
Yeah, I'm trying to find something. Just bringing up Luna real quick kind of reminded me something that got posted to Equestria Daily a little earlier. I guess it got taken down. But there was somebody stating on 4chan that they were part of the production staff and were stating that certain things might happen. But the more you started reading it, the dumber it started sounding. Like,
it's like, let me eat an entire bag of salt to go with this.
Yeah, it was like a character that redeemed themselves is turning bad again. So everybody went, oh, God, Luna! Oh, Nightmare Moon again! And there were some other weird things that didn't really make much sense. But yeah, I think it was all
troll.
I think it was all 4chan trolling. So, however, okay, I do have one more link, and then we can take a little break. I'll have some sort of interlude taken from the show, and we can talk about episodes. But I do want to bring up, we do have another podcast out there, the Diamond Dogs podcast. A bunch of people all the way, I mean, there's a Brit, there's a Canadian, there was a guy who was from Alabama, so, you know, or actually Georgia. I think it was Georgia, so he's in your area. Cool. Yeah, just talking about ponies and doing their whole thing, and they're getting themselves off the ground, so I wanted to give them a little bit of love. We posted several days before them, so I am officially saying that we are the Big Macintosh to their Applejack.
But they were the first to get up on Equestria Daily, so...
Well, you know what? Applejack's more, you know, is a mainline pony at this point, opposed to Macintosh that shows up every once in a while. And we wanted to make sure
cool.
we were good. We wanted to make sure that we, you know, got the sound and people didn't just, you know, throw us off the internet, so... This was a conscious effort by us just to be like, hey, listen, you know, me and Chef talked about it, and like, let's give it a few episodes and make sure people don't just want to murder us. Why are you talking about it? Especially
my
girlfriend.
You guys are both veteran podcasters, though.
No?
Yeah, but the other people that are on the show aren't necessarily.
Well, yeah.
And it's just a little bit different. You know, last time it was only over Skype, but at least here we can see each other.
Yeah, we don't run over each other's words too much. You know? Mm-hmm. So we can actually get... You can see my fingers. If I do this one, you feel mean. Okay, I just flipped off the co-host. Anyway, I need to go on. We need to take a break.
That's cool.
And once we do that, I'll do a quick water break. We'll come back, talk about the two most recent episodes, Owl's Well, The Inn's Well, and Party of One. Then we'll finish up with a final five and be done with this. Might be going long, so we might cut this into a two-parter. We'll see. Anyway, break time. Enjoy this, and we'll be back in a second.
Yay. Ugh, you're gonna cheer for me like that? Louder.
Yay.
Louder!
Yay.
Louder!
Yay.
Okay, and we're back. It's time to talk episodes, funness, stuff like that. So we got two... Oh, cough away from the mic. So overcome with two episodes.
Oh, I just can't handle it.
There you go. Well, let's see.
I have a touch of vapors.
Yeah. Yeah. It's especially knowing what the vapors were at that point. Yeah. Yeah, anybody Wikipedia vapors might not be appropriate for work or however. Hey, my girlfriend's here, and she's giving me slight snide looks again. Hey, everyone. Hey, Internet, say hi.
Hey.
Internet said hi to you, baby. She's just looking at her...
Hi, Saber.
She's just looking at her iPhone, upset the fact I'm still doing this. Yeah, she's
well,
mumbling.
I was...
She's mumbling, I deserve to give her Jamba Juice, so... Looks like we're going out later. Anyway.
Jamba Juice, is that what you're calling it?
No, it's Jamba Juice is totally, it's a chain out here. It is a juicery.
Oh.
It is a place where and you get juice, and you get weird wheatgrass stuff, and it's overpriced, and it's just juice.
I thought you were talking about some sort of cocktail.
She keeps talking. She says that they have drinks and stuff, and it's delicious, and I don't get it. I can go get concentrate for 25 cents at a grocery store. She doesn't understand. She doesn't understand my East...
That was from them wheat worms?
Yeah, she don't understand my East Coast sentiment of juice come in a can. And you pour water on top of it and it's now juice. She has to get some sort of barista to make her juice.
Sounds like a hippie to me.
You need a microphone if we are going to have this conversation. See.
I think it's funnier one-sided.
Yeah, I get to play both sides. I'm sure the internet listening audience loves our back and
this
forth.
This is some
banter.
Gripping radio. Right
I
here,
know.
Let me tell you that
right here on Bronyville, you get one-sided radio conversations. Okay, well let's talk episodes. Let's talk first one
let's
going
talk.
In.
Let's talk.
Episode was it 23 or 24? That's All's Well That Ends Well. Would that
it's
be
24.
All right. All's Well That Ends Well. This is officially spoiler town, so if you've not gotten up to All's Well That Ends Well and then later Party of One, probably should back off of the rest of this episode. We're not going to have anything good to say about you after this. Man, those jerks who don't watch the episodes when we say so are jerks. Anyway.
But we love them anyway.
We do. Keep listening. So, All's Well That Ends Well. Pretty much a Spike-dominated episode. You know, much needed, I think.
Probably. Well, establish him as something besides Twilight's pet.
Yeah, just shows up and be like, "Hey, go fetch me this."
Yes.
Hey, look, there's Rarity. I like her. Pretty much, that's been it for a while. It was a decent episode. You know, coming off of Cutie Mark Crusaders, it was a hard one to follow up, but it was not a bad episode.
I would definitely say. A very middling episode, but still not that bad, really. I mean,
there were points that were, you know, it probably wasn't the strongest. There were definitely some scenes, for instance, the owl slow head turn definitely came into the creepy category of just like, like somebody's going to make an image macro of that. What was it? The Diamond Dogs guys actually made a point of just like, how dumb is it to get mad at Twilight for the fact, to get mad at Spike for the fact that he's a dragon who breathes fire who accidentally roasted a book in a library in a tree?
That's bound to happen. In fact, I'm surprised it hadn't happened before.
Yeah.
But, you know, she was mad because he lied to her.
Pretty much. That was pretty much the best of it, of him just trying to look good. He ended up hiding stuff and then, you know, ended up getting in bigger trouble later because he was trying to
lesson well
like
learned.
He was so awesome. So, I thought it was a pretty decent episode. As said, it wasn't great. What was the owl's name again? It was Aloysius.
Aloysius.
Say, there you go, girlfriend.
Aloysius.
Tell me everything.
And They even had to go get Lauren to spell it on her DA. It's Owl, O-W-I-S-C-I-O-U-S, at least according to the wiki here. And I'm like, what?
Owl.
It's sort of a pun name, but not, because Aloysius is the name of, like, some Greek author.
And she's a bookworm. She would know that sort of thing. That's kind of cool. That's a cool reference there. I also like the Spike Lee whiplash from that episode.
Mm-hmm.
Spike and his mustaches, nice. Telling you.
The mustaches
are just funny.
They just does it. Get Snips and Snails back in with some mustaches, and we can rock it again.
Mm-hmm.
No love for the snips and snails. Oh, well, I don't really like them anyway.
No, because they're boys. We don't want boys. We want the girl ponies.
They are stereotypical idiot ponies, so.
Hi.
Yeah. I kind of hope they get their own episode later.
Yeah. Hi.
They'll probably still end up looking like idiots, but at least we'd know why they were idiots, maybe. Who knows?
Get into the deep backstory of Snips and Snails. Why is he called Snips?
When are we going to see... Because it's a pun on boys. I don't know. When are we going to see the puppy dog tails pony there? That's what I'm waiting for.
He's the, he's where they get the mysterious sandwich meat from.
Oh, dear.
Some of this, the weird ones, it's have an adventure where it's Snips, Snails, and Pokey. Everybody's just going around with just the three weirdest kind of like, wait a second, you're a unicorn that just
goes
around.
What's your talent?
I pop balloons. There's a great comic where it's just like, come on, Spike, we're having an adventure, and it's them and their balloon, and it's just Pokey there with a bunch of balloons. It's like, hi, how you doing? And the next thing is a crime scene.
Yes.
That's a good one. That was a nice one. So,
some of those comics, I tell you.
They're pretty good.
But at least the age top for this one was, it was good, because this is aimed at kids, and it's one of those things where, if your friend gets a new friend, it's not going to destroy the friendship that you have. And it was sort of illustrated kind of interestingly, with him doing the sort of stereotypical cartoon, trying to frame the owl for murdering a mouse, and,
in the end,
it works out because it's a cartoon, but it's like, wow, that's a bit much.
I know. I really sympathize with Spike, though. As far as the fear of being replaced, yeah.
Fake simulated mouse blood. Well, there's a child show for you. Look, it's bleeding. Something
so
died
nice,
here.
Like, he no. tears up the fluff. All sorts of stuff. It's like,
They
track him through the forest by some very persistent ketchup.
Yeah, that was...
Because that's how it works.
The most persistent of ketchups. And all the whole running away thing. And then suddenly, hey, look, new dragon.
Dragons seem to be the D students of Equestria all of a sudden.
They live on the edge of a Dungeon Dragons forest. They got cockatrice and manticores and dragons and other such things.
Mm-hmm.
Hydras.
Roll for initiative. I have to tell you, Applejack really wins her initiative rolls most of the time. She's good.
She's fast.
Yeah.
She'll
kick you in the face.
Yeah, sure will. Crazy dodge. Pinkie Pie, luck.
He's there.
Just luck like crazy.
I'm just waiting for the MLP tabletop game, because someone's creating that right now.
There are D&D stats. Somebody has created D&D pages for them.
Really?
For Earth Ponies,
really?
For Unicorns, and for Pegasus. I can find them for
Why
you.
Why have I not seen this?
I'll forward it
Why
to you
Why are we
later.
Not playing this but, right now?
All right. I don't have much dice, but tell you what, I'll be game masters. All right. The scene opens.
Why are
Ponyville.
We wasting our time with a podcast? All right.
Hold on, I'm setting the scene. Roll for initiative, party.
Let's perhaps do that in another episode. Talk about episodes.
Chef's ruining it for us, Fluff. We gotta get rid of him.
I know.
He's bumming my style here.
Bringing us back down to reality.
I know.
The reality that is ponies.
Very chaotic in this show. Whatever. Okay, so, I thought it was okay. I mean, nothing to really be like, I want to watch this one over and over and over, like Sonic Rainboom or the Cutie Mark Chronicles, where it's just like, game classic, so good. But still,
Dress
good in its own
success,
right.
Yeah.
Oh, good, yeah, great one. But yeah, just a pretty general, basic, good episode. Put it probably on par with... whatever the one with Pinky and the just trust because weird things happen episode.
Oh, feeling Pinky Keen.
Yeah, feeling Pinky Keen. Just like, this is an episode. Some funny stuff.
That was the same writer, though, wasn't it?
Chef knows more about that. Chef? I don't know.
Chef? I believe the...
Pull up the stats.
Oh, God.
He's the smart one.
I'm pretty sure that the person who wrote Cindy Morrow... had previously done Winter Wrap Up and one other episode.
Winter Wrap Up, really? Good one, like that one.
I think she did Winter Wrap Up and Cutie Mark Chronicles.
Wow, okay.
I believe those were her two episodes up until All Owls Well That Ends Well.
Hmm.
Maybe not on par with those two, but I could see how they're similar.
Yeah, I could see that. Yeah, that works. Okay. Think we've exhausted owls at this point? Which?
Yeah, there's really not a lot to talk about on the episode. Amazing.
That one was kind of standard. Now, Party of One.
Owl.
Let's talk about Party of One, or Pinky starts to lose it.
Oh my goodness.
Oh man. All right, Pinky throws a party. The next day, decides to throw party. Nobody wants to. Everybody, you know, ditches out of wanting to go to party. Pinky loses her mind.
Oh, actually, I was wrong. Cindy Morrow wrote Griffin the Brush Off, Winter Wrap Up, and Showstoppers.
I like Showstoppers, actually. It looked like it wasn't going to be the
Showstoppers.
Showstoppers was all right. At first, I didn't like the song, and then when I heard all the remixes, I'm like, okay, all right, I got it.
Better. Yeah.
Yeah, that.
That's another episode where the fan content made it worthwhile.
Yeah, fan content kind of redeemed it. Okay. But yeah, mm-hmm. Party of One, Crazy Pinkie Pie, losing it, Madame Lafleur and Rocky and her making new friends and losing her pinkiness. Holy
and crap. Watching
your hair deflate.
She went back to the Cutie Mark Chronicles hair, Pinkamina. And the writer for this episode was Megan McCarthy, and she's actually done some really good ones. Dragon Shy, Call the Cutie, and Green Isn't Your Color, with the fourth one she did being Party of One. Mm-hmm. And she does character episodes really well.
Yeah, that was... That was pretty astounding. You had something fluky.
I don't think that this episode did a whole lot to develop Pinky as a character, so much as some of the other ones did. But I don't know. I just have mixed feelings about it.
Huh.
I got the impression that she has a lot of self confidence issues.
She has a lot of abandonment issues, probably. You know, she doesn't live at home. Their family or anything.
Yeah, I mean, she's not living or not living on the rock farm, which may or may not exist, so,
yeah.
You know.
With Violetta and Achromatia, I think the fans have dubbed them Achromatic Pie and Violetta Pie.
There you go.
I love those. Wow.
Good going, fans, when your crazy names of people of miscellany ponies.
Incidental background ponies.
Have they come up with names for the parents yet? I'd be kind of curious on that.
No.
Oh, okay. Get to work.
Not yet.
You got homework.
It's just Amish dad pony and Amish mom pony.
Yeah. Well, yeah. But
yes,
Party
of One, you know, I really enjoyed it sort of with the callback. You know, one of the things that I like about ponies is that they do callbacks to earlier shows. You can see, you know, they... know their cartoons, I guess. Some of the stuff, like the whole splashes of color thing when Pinky's losing her mind is sort of a callback to Ren and Stimpy, mm-hmm. which was not nearly as innocent or cute or childlike as Ponies is, but the people doing the animation are probably the
but
ones
God,
that watched
just
it.
That, just that camera tilt and just the eyes going, like...
Yeah...
Wow. If that would have went one way sideways, we would have got cupcakes. Just like, I've got to go find my friends. Here,
don't
give
remind
me, the
me please.
Yeah, there. Hey, you were the one that decided to read. I'll find you those alternate endings, okay? Just so you can sleep tonight.
Please do. Please do.
The episode was a treasure trove of images. You know, people always make stuff out of the episodes, but this one had a lot of good reaction shots.
Applejack has that weird neck thing.
They all do that weird neck thing from time to time. What's up with that?
Just it's weird.
The neck grows to three times as long as the rest of their body.
I love, like, the weird, disproportionate things. One of my favorite ones is the, just to take it off base real quick, is the picture someone did where... it's from the dress episode where they're doing Applejack's hat and it just goes into space. I love that image so much.
Oh,
you just see this red thing, and it just travels down back into the atmosphere past some clouds, and then it's just her just on the set with the wearing the big red hat, and she's just like, oh, maybe it was a bit much. But yeah, I love some of the images, but yeah, just the weirdo long neck and the crazy eyes, the deflated hair, the fact that she went from bright pink to this muted dark pink. Like,
did she? I didn't notice that at first.
She went like into this grayish pink. It was bizarre.
That's subtle. Wow.
Yeah, and then the moment she kicks back in, it's just, you know, she just bam, pink again.
Colors back in her world.
Yeah, it's weird.
That's a nice touch there.
Yeah.
You know what I didn't like about this episode, though?
Do it. Wait.
Is it now?
You didn't
officially...
like Gummy? I hate you. You can't hate Gummy.
Gummy's okay. The fact that Gummy now has officially more screen time than Winona is a little upsetting to me.
Okay. But I do have to say that very end part with the balloon was pretty funny.
Yeah, that was cute.
Yeah, that was pretty good. I don't know. I thought it was a pretty good episode. It was definitely not. It was. I think one step below probably Cooney Mark Chronicles, but it was definitely a damn fine episode.
Oh yeah, it definitely one that you can rewatch over and over again and still enjoy.
Good way to bring it there, Chef. Just drop it down to a Big Mac quote. Yep. Okay. Well, I think we probably exhausted those two episodes, and I don't know if it's record time or not. So let's do this. However, we're still figuring it out. Still good. I like this episode thus far. It's sounding all right. Chef's making weird gestures in his, you know, in his webcam. I don't know if he's trying to shake two coconuts or... Oh, look. Now he's in a wave.
I'm dancing.
There you go.
I'm dancing.
Somebody get vinyl scratch in on this. We need some beats. All right. Anyway, let's wrap this up. I've got five final questions I'll drop on this.
Wait.
Oh.
Are you skipping over the cool things we found?
What cool
things?
We
found some cool things.
Wait, where are they? Where are they in the notes?
Above the episode lists.
Oh, hey, I completely forgot that. We'll tell you what, we'll add those in here. One cool thing that we found. I don't know how I missed that. Cool, we can add this right after the episodes and do the final five. Okay, this will actually tie in, since it's later in the episode, it'll actually work pretty well, so I can use this as outro music. One cool thing I found. So, I did some searching. I was kind of curious because I'm interested in getting into voiceover work. I decided, well, let's find out who does the voiceover. So I tracked down the voiceover actress who does both Rainbow Dash and Applejack. That is Ashley Ball, Vancouver native, who does all the stuff up there. Has done stuff for Care Bears and a bunch of other shows and anime projects as well. Just springboarding off of that, I found an interview based off of a Canadian news source, which was about band members who have their secondary jobs, and her secondary job was voiceover, which leads to the question of, wait, if her secondary is voiceover, then what's the band? Which leads to me finding the band, which is called Hey Ocean. And Hey Ocean sounds pretty damn good. So I have one of their songs I'm going to attach to the very end of this episode. So you get to hear a song sung by Applejack / Rainbow Dash that's called Song About California. And it's, I like it. It sounds good. It's got a really good beat to it.
You can pretend that this is what Applejack would sound like if she'd grown up in Manhattan.
Yeah, pretty much.
You know what kind of thought? I kind of thought she looks a little bit like Applejack, too, when she sings. So.
Yeah, I might find the clip, but she's got, there was an interview she did, that interview. Most of it she was doing, like, Care Bears and stuff like that, but the very beginning, this was done even before, like, the My Little Ponies really caught on. But she's doing some voiceover work, and she's just like, how do I hold all these apples in my hooves? 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 And, you know, she does the Applejack voice and just kind of ad-libs some stuff for them. And it's just like, yes, copy. Yes, cool. You know. So definitely check it out. Ashley Ball, Hey Ocean, Song About California. Check out our other stuff. If you look at the YouTube comments, every once of them, every once in a while you'll see like, hey, it's really cool to, you know, hey, love your stuff, hey, and just a Rainbow Dash, Applejack, you know, just the YouTube comments will sometimes just degenerate into pony love, you know, you find that. Okay, Chef Sandy, you've put me an AV Club article here, so let's go with it.
Yes, it's an article for the Onion AV Club, which talks about My Little Pony Friends with Magic, and it's like, I don't believe it, but I'm talking about My Little Ponies, and it's good. And, you know, Onion AV Club is obviously aimed a little bit higher than middle school or whatever, and certainly not the primary audience. But then again, I can't say that anybody listening to this isn't the primary audience for My Little Pony.
Bronies unite.
So they give it a good write-up, and generally the, you know, there's plenty of Paris Brights in the comment thread, but it's the internet, it's what you're going to expect. And but the guy's like, you know, give it a shot. It's a weekly half hour of bright colors for best friends and rainbows galore. And I'm like, cool.
Yeah, try and find
it out there.
Try and find a 23-minute cartoon out there on any channel nowadays. It's going to be hard to find, you know, some substantial cartoonerage going on here. Okay, Floof, what you got? Floofa.
I found... okay, granted, I didn't do quite as much research, I suppose. I just linked to a post from Equestria Daily where a user going by the handle Flash in the Pan, who occasionally pops into comments and cartoons on 4chan, just has a bunch of people ask him questions about development of My Little Pony's Friendship is Magic, and he answers them to the best of his abilities. He's one of the layout artists, so he doesn't have a whole lot to say about, you know, story or character development or a lot of the things that I'm sure people ask him. But it's pretty informative, actually. He goes into some of the process, which I thought was pretty cool. And this just ties into him, and I know Lauren does a lot of answering questions on her Deviant account. And I just think it's so neat that they're involved with the fans.
Jeez, this just keeps going. Words, 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 words. Man, I'm going to have to go over this later. That's pretty cool.
Yes.
All right, I think those are three definite cool things. Yeah. They're talking about MMOs. God, this is nuts. These people are actually, like, responding. I've never seen any, like, creators of something be this open to just be like, no, that idea's dumb. Hey, that's kind of cool. Yes, mm-hmm. We've seen that, you know.
It's unique, that's for sure.
Yeah. They know what they're doing, and I hope Hasbro, at least, you know, are understanding that they're doing something kind of cool and, you know, don't jump in and do something crazy. Oh, Hasbro overlords, be intelligent. Okay, so we're ready for final five. We're ready to get out of here?
Yep.
All right, final five question. Okay, number one, Rainbow Dash needs a pet. What is it? Starting with Floofy.
A turtle.
Turtle. Name.
Sure, it'd be funny.
Speedy.
Speedy the Turtle, sure. Going back to Swan Princess there.
I choose something different. I think Turtle would be good. I want to call it Prometheus.
Prometheus the Turtle?
Just to make it just bizarre. Because, you know, you might as well just give everything a strange name added to it. Okay, we need to make Weird Al's character. What's it going to be?
I've already seen fan art of him. It's,
Yeah,
he's an Earth pony with a baloney cutie mark, mm-hmm. playing an accordion. It's great.
That's pretty good.
I could see that. I could see that being Weird Al.
For some reason, I see him as a uni, though. I don't know why. I see him as a unicorn.
He has the crazy hair fro thing like he always has for a mane.
He's very Pinkie Pie, I feel.
Yeah.
I hope.
Had to be related if he's on the show.
I hope they bring it on, and there's definitely some Pinkie Pie crossover that would be great.
Watch him be like her uncle or something like that. That would be amazing.
Yeah. Al Pie.
Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh. Let's go eat pie. Yay, pie! You know, they're just like
we hey, kids.
Just you have Rainbow Dash just going like, oh god, there's two of them. Okay. Two new side characters. Which is cooler, Rocky or Madame Lefleur? The crazy psychedelic things that Pinky talked to in the latest episode.
Rocky. He's like a childhood friend.
I like Madame Lefleur.
Madame Lefleur.
She's a classy old bag.
Classy old bag of flour, that's for sure.
Yes.
They don't like you. All right, we got to go give Gummy a birthday gift. What are you giving him?
How about
a blender?
A blender?
A beach ball.
Oh, boy, I got to make that up.
Yeah.
A big old bunch of gummy bears, because that would just be funny to watch them eat.
Oh.
That works.
How ironic.
Yeah. All right, and if you were a pony, what is your snack of choice?
Hay fries.
Oats.
The blood of my enemies. No,
That's not very pony of you.
Apple cider. There. Might as well. It'd be the cutie mark. It'd be my drink. There.
All right.
Snack of choice. All right, we're done. Let's close this. Let's
Yay.
Ship it. Pony's done. I'll cut this into two episodes or however the heck we're going to do it. So
GG,
that,
guys.
GG. Good game.
Okie dokie dokie.
You know, what? That's one of the things that I need to do for next episode. I really want to try out the TF2 community and see how that is. That's supposed to be nuts.
They are a fun bunch.
Yeah, I got to jump in there. So, you know what? I think there's one more thing that we have to do right before we close out. Dear Princess Celestia, what exactly did we learn today? Well,
Pinky has severe abandonment issues, and her overactive personality is extreme rebellion to her restrictive upbringing.
I learned that there's some creepy pony-related things out there, but she just got to accept it because we're all brony.
I think I learned that, you know, it's not that different new things sometimes aren't going to be bad, and that you have to just go with them, and if you don't like them, that's fine. If not, you just got to keep going, moving on, shuffling on. So, yeah, send that all on up. Okay, I think we're all starting to get harassed by significant others. I gotta go get some Jamba Juice, so probably need to go ahead and call this one off. That was Bronyville. Catch you all on sometime later.
Adios.
Farewell.
Bye. Oh, sleep well, bronies.
Write a song about California, he said. Write a song about California, he said to me before I left. But I think I'll write a song about him instead. Now, I'm sitting up on Hollywood Hill. Can't think of a single thing to sing about this place. Maybe I never will, but I'm thinking about you still. Walking down some
rock.